Federal and state governments introduce various intervention policies that will nip the problem, such as free and compulsory education for all at all levels, free uniforms, and the homegrown school feeding. This led to a rise in the enrollment figure in Kano State from 3 million to 4 million pupils. Under the feeding program, about 1.2 million children are benefiting from the program, while efforts are being intensified to capture the remaining pupils in the second phase of the program.
The predicament is created by the large scope or size of basic education in Kano State. We have the largest number of schools in the country. We have the largest number of pupils in our schools in the country. And Gamma resources are, you know, very, very low, very, very abysmally low. And therefore, government, even though it's trying very hard to meet the demand, the resource demand of basic education, government alone cannot do it.
At Rumawa community, one of the oldest settlements in Kano, with about 15,000 people, this community has no access to the universal basic education, despite its proximity to the metropolis. But the community came together and built a school out of stalls and sticks. What is amazing here is the level of enrollment and eagerness to learn by these children.
I want to be an army officer. I want to become a doctor. I want to become a teacher.
But government is addressing the issue through so many ways. For instance, government has created or established education promotion committees in all the 44 local government areas of the state with a view to engendering community participation, because education for all is the responsibility of all. We'll continue to do our best, and therefore I'm calling on the communities, all well-meaning citizens of Kano State, philanthropists, the well-to-do, civil society organizations, to come to the aid of education in Kano State, and by extension to all parts of the north. Kano is a melting pot. We have an influx of people into Kano who have made Kano their homes, and they are producing children. And there is a law that mandates government to provide free compulsory education to every child. But the home truth is, government alone cannot do it.
While the Rumawa community continue to push for their rights, Fidosi and millions like her who are deprived access to education on account of their indigent background may continue to live on streets.
As part of efforts to revitalize primary school and teacher education in Edo, Delta, and Ekiti states, the various governments are carrying out massive reforms. These reforms include the introduction of new teaching models intended to strengthen infrastructure in the respective states. Adogbeji Ojegba has more details.
In time past, the educational sector recorded unstable staff, inadequate classroom accommodation, poorly equipped libraries, lack of government concern, and inadequate research development. The narrative changed in 1999. With the insertion of the Buhari-led administration, it promised to make a full review of the Universal Basic Education Act with emphasis on gender equity in primary and secondary school enrollment, whilst improving the quality and substance of schools. It also went a step further by providing one meal a day for all primary school pupils, enhancing teacher training and improving teacher competence through training and provision of learning tools. The out-of-school children phenomenon was addressed with a bottom-up approach utilizing the pyramid approach. In Edo State, apart from infrastructural development, institutional reforms, the state is also providing educational materials to the teachers to enhance competence.
The governor is very eager to start the process of renovating our schools and constructing new schools. So all of that modalities are in place, and we are sort of almost finalizing it. So within the next couple of weeks, few weeks, you're going to be hearing, seeing the renovation and construction work that will be going on in our schools.
They need things like things that they can see, visual aids, like the internet. They need the computer training. Then the one that bothers me most is that of a higher institution. The amenities are not enough. That's why you find out that lecturers are always going on strike.
Government is trying, and we also want them to try harder.
Also in Ekiti State, Kehinde Durudola reports that in order to revitalize education and realize the objective of the Universal Basic Education Program, quality teacher education has been encouraged. Talent discovery and vocational training has been stepped up to improve and encourage professional competence within the sector.
If vocational and technical education are inculcated into our curriculum, I'm sure it can reduce the level of dropouts. We need competent teachers. We need good equipment for this to function well in the schools.
The economy of Nigeria now should be productive. It will be production-based, not all these buy and sell.
And from Delta State, Kirsten Peters reports that the government of Delta State is keeping faith with the program to ensure the functionality and sustainability of the program.
We have a very strong synergy with UBEC Abuja through our State Universal Basic Education Board, SUBEB. To this end, we have made sure that our counterpart funding are up to date. The last time Delta State accessed UBEC funds was in 2012. So one of the very first things we had to do was to make sure that we came up to date from 2012 up to 2015. But as we speak now, we're up to date till 2018. And this has entailed the state government putting approximately 6.6 billion naira of counterpart funds to be able to access the UBEC grant. Now, we have 100% intervention rate in our 6 technical colleges. I believe that we are actually one of the few states that have done very well in technical education. When we had an education summit in early in the life of this administration, one area that stood out was teacher quality and human capital and teacher improvement.
There should be constant in-service training for the UBE teachers.
The initiative by the various state governments have received accolades from different fora, like Edo State, who received global endorsement. Rwandan government has modeled its basic education system after Edo State Nobel Program, Edo Best. However, in spite of the success stories, consensus are of the opinion that government should do more to avoid levies currently being charged in schools.
There is significant increase in schools enrollment in Borno State, especially that of the girl child, as Universal Basic Education Board in just 2018 and 2019 academic year registered over 200,000 pupils in public schools across the state. This, no doubt, is as a result of improved security situation and quantum of intervention programs in the education sector, having suffered great setback in the years of insurgency. Naomi Abuaku has more.
I have the Nigerian flag, how many colors for him? What about?
Education is among the worst hit sectors in Borno State, where components of basic teaching and learning centers were affected, with teachers killed or threatened to abandon classes. Today, distressed structures have been renovated and new ones constructed, in addition to provision of over 30 ultramodern schools established by Borno State government through the UBE intervention program of the federal government. This has tremendously increased school enrollment and retention of pupils and students, while the mega schools are ready for commencement of service.
Enrollment into these mega schools, 60 for the girls and 40% for the boys in terms of enrollment into the new mega schools. These mega schools embedded the technologies of developed world teaching aids, learning support, compatibility of the learning environment. And then we also provide platform for the IDPs to have education.
The primary and nursery, they are all under UBE. And then now, currently we enroll about 4,800 students for the morning and afternoon sessions. And then the morning is going to accommodate 2,400 students, while the afternoon is going to accommodate the same numbers. And then the issue of nursery is going to be nursery 1, 2, 3.
This is in addition to support and reconstruction effort of development partners to include PCNI, PINE and VSF. The Universal Basic Education Borno has recorded huge successes in providing enabling environment and quality education to pupils and students owing to the state government's ability to settle up to date its counterfunding.
Borno State virtually in a state of war. We are able to access our own matching grants. So we here would go on to maintain and sustain the tempo of progress in terms of provision of quality basic education in the state.
We already have in place over 1,000 teachers have already been interviewed. We are going to recruit them. And that is to especially bear in mind that we need qualitative teachers to man these schools. It's not just building the schools. And I believe even after this 1,000, we are still going to recruit more teachers, because our belief is that if these schools will serve the purpose they are being constructed, we just have to get teachers, because teachers are the movers of this industry, and if they are not there, it is not going to work.
Initiatives such as the State Education Program Investment Project, funded by the World Bank, was put in place to complement effort of government in ensuring standard of education is maintained through provision of instructional materials and training teachers across the state. The capacity building initiative cut across the 27 local governments of Borno, with 18,000 teachers trained on disaster risk reduction, induction of early warning signs, and psychosocial support, which will in turn positively impact on the educational development of their pupils. The federal government's school feeding system has equally contributed to the development of primary education in the state, leading to overcrowding due to influx of children availing themselves for admissions.
We have about 33 JSS, that UBE schools, junior day secondary school, and we have 39 primary school. In all the school, our government are doing their best.
There are numerous achievements that the government have done, particularly to UBE schools, because 95% of our teachers were being trained.
They are enrolling. They are being given uniforms. We are even tired. We can't even enroll because of the overcrowding of the classes.
The performance of the student now is very, very good than before.
Development partners involved in post-insurgency recovery are contributing greatly in improving standard of teaching and learning in schools through infrastructure, training and retraining of teachers, as well as capacity building for all stakeholders in the education sector for the development of the universal basic education.
For the Bolori one, we divided forms into the traditional rulers, other stakeholders of the Bolori, and then we divide the Bolori into 5 groups. That means 5 zones for the allocation of the forms. And then people collect the form, appreciating the effort, and now they are turning the form back to us, and then we are calling the parents and bring their child for enrollment.
Communities, governmental and non-governmental organizations are synergizing to ensure development of the education sector, with UBE taking the lead in providing the impetus for a sustained progress in the revival of basic foundation.
To provide qualitative education, particularly at the primary level, a robust infrastructural development and provision of up-to-date learning aids are very crucial. Jane Ojukwu examines the state of primary school infrastructure in Lagos and now reports.
Education is key to capacity building of individuals for self-reliance and national development. Against this backdrop, the foundation, which is the primary school level, is the most crucial, as it sets the tone for pupils to acquire the necessary footing upon which their academic aspirations depend.
And there is a need
to lay very solid foundation at the primary school level, because really a lot of your education that you get actually starts from that primary school. If the primary education is wobbly, then it becomes problematic when the person gets to secondary school and eventually to the university. Education is at the primary level. You get your tenses right, you get your words right, and this is very important. Unfortunately, we don't seem to be getting it right at the primary school level, at least as far as the public schools are concerned. But this also vary from state to state. There are some very good schools, primary schools in Lagos State. There are some in other states. But there are also some that are just not worth even being called schools.
Due to the necessity of basic education, it is imperative that the standard must not be compromised in terms of quality. This throws up the question, what is the state of infrastructure in some of the schools in Lagos?
In my own community, the primary schools there are good. They have good students. The classes is okay. And the staff, they always come to school very early. And the government are really trying. They are only renovating some classes that is bad.
Some of these primary schools around me, some of them are okay. But why some of them are not okay like that? But I believe that Lagos State government should look into the instructions and the way they build those primary schools so that they can improve it more.
When I went to the primary school, I was attracted by the infrastructure. The infrastructure was great. I went to a primary school when, in fact, most homes in Nigeria, they have no water system. My primary school had a water system. My primary school has a library. My primary school has a nature study center. My primary school has sufficient field to play football and sufficient bush to actually do crafts. My primary school has very good teachers, teachers that are like mothers, and they restrain you to stay in school. Now, we've lost all that.
How has Lagos State, under whose purview the primary education falls, fared in ensuring that its public primary schools are adequately equipped to provide qualitative education?
We will continue to increase our budgetary allocation to education and health, because those are the critical sectors that we also need to look at. Of course, beyond infrastructure and all of it.
And we need to build the primary school infrastructure. We have to ensure that the state and local government that are responsible for the primary schools, that they do their job. We need to introduce a very powerful inspectorate. And that is what is missing. Nobody does inspection. And we need to do that. I'm talking of public primary schools, which is supported by government, where the poor man and poor woman can send his children. And their lives are forte for the development of this country. We need to go back and see what's happening at that level. We have to increase those who go to public primary school. We need to revamp and re-energize our public primary school.
NTNU's visited the Lagos State Universal Basic Education Board, SUBEB, but its chairman, Mr. Gani Oshokpeyin, declined comments.
Since the UBE program began, there have been some improvements to Nigeria's economic structure. This was evident in the fact that as at 2015, UNESCO ranked Nigeria 103rd out of 118 countries in its Education for All Development Index. This index takes various aspects of education into consideration, including quality of education, gender parity, universal primary education, and also adult literacy. In 2017, the Muhammadu Buhari administration earmarked the sum of 92 billion naira for the UBE scheme. The UBE remains a vital component of societal growth through provision of quality basic education for every Nigerian child. Now that's our bit on Dateline 360 today. Thank you for your time. I remain Lydia Odije Ochi. See you next time.
Along a flyway, seasonally, birds migrate often north and south between breeding and wintering grounds. Many species migrate, and these occur naturally on one hand, even though out of necessity, compelled by other environmental factors on the other hand. This migration carries high cost in predation and mortality, including hunting by humans. Migration is driven primarily by availability of food. It occurs mainly in the northern hemisphere, where birds are funneled onto specific routes by natural barriers such as the Mediterranean and Caribbean seas. Migration dates back to about 3,000 years. Every year, on the 9th of May, the United Nations celebrates World's Migratory Birds Day to create awareness and promote safety of birds that migrate. During flight, some birds become incapacitated and are unable to continue the flight, which explains why sometimes we wake up to the sight of rare species of birds in our compounds. What are we supposed to do should this happen? Globally speaking, in other parts of the world, value is attached to this species of bird, even though that cannot be said about most African countries, Nigeria inclusive, where these birds are hunted down either for food or sold in the market to make money.
Information is power. Everyone wants power. So feel powerful with the NTA News mobile app, the one-stop information center. Real news at your fingertip. Be the first to report by uploading first-hand information on the U-Report link, and be the first to know by simply clicking on any of the links on the sidebar for headlines, domestic and foreign news, economy, security, politics, sports, and more. Stream live on your smartphone and tablets and stay connected. It's pretty easy. Simply download NTA News app from your Google Play Store and you're good to go. NTA News mobile app, your access to real-time information.
Issues in the sports sector remain one of the most debated among Nigerians due to the passion, followership, government involvement, impact on Nigeria's external image on our national life in the sports parliament. The NTA offers Nigerians deep views on issues with experts in the sports sector offering in-depth analysis, hindsight, insight and foresight towards elevating Nigerian sports to the zenith on the floor of the sports parliament. Sports Parliament, a unique platform for sports discussions, showing live on the NTA. Keep a date with the parliamentarians.
The eyes have it.
Imagine a station where you access information. Think of a station that creates awareness for national development.
Tuesday Live. I am Omini Odun. It's a countdown to the inauguration of a new administration in the country at the national level, at the state levels, And after then, we'll say the public governance structure has taken off in the country. Our focus tonight is in the legislature. Precisely after the 9th of June this year, the 9th National Assembly will be inaugurated. The All Progressive Congress, the ruling party, has zoned certain positions for Senate and the House of Representatives Speaker. This is in a zoning bid to engender balancing and equity in the power sharing amongst the zones. The constitution of the leadership of the 9th National Assembly, many believe, has already generated unnecessary controversy, which should not be, given that the APC has the majority of seats with candidates of tested character and worth. There are those who think that the current leadership battle for the 9th National Assembly is not any different from the situation in the 8th National Assembly and likely to come out with surprises. How true? Why so much interest in the leadership of the 9th National Assembly? What do you deduce from Senate President Bukola Saraki and Speaker Yakubu Dogara's statements that the independence of the legislature was non-negotiable, more so that the lawmakers would choose their leaders themselves at the appropriate time? These are the concerns we'll be looking at on Tuesday Live tonight, but after this background report put together by Ignatius Nkwo.
The journey of the 8th National Assembly took off with the inauguration of members-elect from all states of the Federation and the Federal Capital Territory on the 9th of June 2015. After the emergence of presiding officers amidst high-level power play against the will of the ruling party, legislative business commenced with the announcement of standing committees. The Senate's first major oversight function was the confirmation of ministerial nominees from the president and the subsequent passage of the 2015 supplementary budget. For the House of Representatives, it was the passage of that supplementary budget. The 8th National Assembly has passed three annual budgets, 2016, 2017, and 2018. The 2016 budget was controversial as some members of the House of Representatives accused their leadership of padding the budget.
There was serious scrutiny of the budget. Unlike in those days when the budget comes on Monday, it is passed on Wednesday, on Thursday.
With 4 years almost gone, the National Assembly has passed more than 200 bills. These include the National Institute for Cancer Research Treatment Establishment Bill, Agricultural Credit Guarantee Scheme Act Amendment Bill, the Food Security Bill, Petroleum Industry Governance Bill, and the Northeast Development Commission Bill.
That will be charged specifically with the responsibility of reconstruction and rehabilitation of the Northeast as a result of the destruction occasioned by the Boko Haram insurgency.
To liberate the Northeast from the Boko Haram insurgency.
The Nigerian Financial Intelligence Agency Establishment Bill, Whistleblowers Protection Bill, the Nigerian Diaspora Commission Bill, National Child Protection and Enforcement Bill, the National Transport Commission Bill, and the Not Too Young to Run Bill were also among the major achievements of the 8th National Assembly. The 8th National Assembly also considered more than 28 constitutional transition bills, and recently the new National Minimum Wage Bill.
Those against say nay, the ayes have it.
This administration has fulfilled its promise to do this, give a new national minimum wage to the Nigerian workers, and it has fulfilled that promise.
The TSA, which has come out to be an intervention that has saved a lot of money for the government, came as a result of a motion which we passed,
bill on the establishment of Institute of Cancer Development and Cure of Cancer, which had been assented to by the president.
More than 30 bills did not receive presidential assent. Some are being reconsidered. These include the Petroleum Industry Governance Bill and the Constitutional Alteration Bill, which seeks to mandate the executive to present annual budgets 3 months to the end of the year. The 8th National Assembly passed resolutions on several national issues, such as halting the planned hike of data by Nigerian Communications Commission, and also initiated the National Assembly Joint Public Hearing on Budget and the Business Environment Roundtable.
Nigeria had a movement by almost 24 points in the ease of doing business ranking by the World Bank. This was as a result of the National Assembly Business Environment Roundtable.
The House of Representatives, on the other hand, convened sectoral debate where ministers were invited to make submissions on how to improve the economy and pulled it out of recession, especially through diversification. Within the period under review, the legislature and executive relationship has been described as cordial.
I want to believe that it is only better when the two arms of government will imbibe the spirit of the separation of power and the rule of law.
Apart from this agreement between some heads of government agencies, the 8th National Assembly has had some controversial bills as well, including the bill that sought to regulate social media, which was eventually thrown out. The Senate in the last 4 years had suspended two of its members, reshuffled the leadership of its standing committees twice. However, the invasion and snatching away of the Senate maze in April 2018 by unknown persons was a turning point in the life of the 8th Senate. While the House of Representatives reshuffled its standing committees once and suspended one of its members. However, the 8th National Assembly has faced a number of criticisms ranging from the call by some Nigerians to cut their pay package and their inability to commence full implementation of the e-parliament as contained in its legislative agenda. With 1 month to the end of this assembly, the question now is, will the 9th assembly draw from the happenings in the outgoing assembly to build on a robust legislative assembly come June 2019? Ignatius
Nkwo, NTN News. That up by Ignatius Nkwo sets the path for the discussion tonight on Tuesday Live, which is a periscope into the 9th National Assembly, which is a countdown for inauguration. Well, as usual, at some point, we shall be taking phone calls. And if the time gets there, when we take your call, you turn down the volume of your set and put your issue straight. Go straight to the point, you don't need to rigmarole, and we'll get the program done within time. Well, I have a full house to my immediate left. I have His Excellency, the Governor of Plateau State, Right Honorable Simon Lanong. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Thank you very much.
Also tonight is the Senator representing Kano North Senatorial District, Senator Jibrin Barau. He's also Chairman, Senate Committee, Tertiary Education and Debt Fund. It's good to have you on Tuesday Live.
Good to be with you. Good evening.
Chief Michael Ajayi is a political analyst and a public affairs commentator. It's good to have you.
Thank you for having me.
Beautiful. Well, within the ambit of separation of powers, people will say you